Cruelty Nation, it's your host, Abhi Kohar. Welcome to the podcast of all podcasts. Listen, you are watching the show today because you want to know how to get the best financing for your real estate deal. And my guest today is Andrew Sirius, and we're talking about exactly how you can do that. As a pro, as a newbie, listen, money is what runs this world. You need to have money and you need to have deals. If you don't have either of these two things, you're kind of SOL. And we're going to talk about how not to be in that position, how you can get the best financing, what you need to do to submit your loan, and how you can look strong to your lenders. So before we get to Andrew, I need to give a huge shout out to the sponsor for today's show, and that is Rentify. This episode of the Think Realty podcast is brought to you by Rentify. Rentify is a verification platform allowing property management companies and real estate investors to instantly verify a prospective renter's financial information. Their bank check report provides a summary of payroll, income, rent, and bill payment history and highlights red flags such as payment issues, payday loan activity, frequent overdraft, past bankruptcies, and more. So obviously very, very important to know. To learn more about Rentify, visit www.trustrentify.com. Remember to use coupon code ThinkRealty for 20% off your first purchase. So, good stuff. Andrew, welcome to the show. Let's get started.
Thank you. How are you doing? My pleasure to be here. Thank you for having me.
Absolutely. Give us a little background on who you are, what you do, and we'll jump right into it.
Yeah, so I'm a real estate investor. Buy and hold is our focus. I work with my brother, Philip, and my father, Bill. I'm out here in Kansas City, Missouri. We buy and hold mostly single family, but also some multis. We have just over 500 units. And I also write regularly for Think Realty and have our own YouTube channel, The Sirius Brothers. So you can check us out there, too.
Nice. Sounds great. We're talking about financing today. It's a very interesting topic. A lot of challenges for new investors to find the right financing, even maybe put together a package that makes sense for a financier, for a hard money lender, private money lender. Right off the bat, what are some of the initial tips that you would have for some of these folks?
I think the main thing I would say is your best bet is going to be with community banks. With a couple exceptions. The first one, I'll go through the exceptions first. And that is if you're just getting your foot in the door using an FHA loan to buy, say, like a duplex or try, you can buy up to a fourplex and you can get 96.5% financing. You have to live there for at least a year, but this is a great way to get your foot in the door. You can also buy up to 10 houses with Fannie Mae loans, which have to be in your own name. And those are better financing. It's not 96.5%, but they're better financing. You get up to 10 of those loans. And you can do, or you can do conventional loans, but if you're doing them as a homeowner, you're getting much better rates, much better LTVs. You're getting, you know, when I bought my own home, my personal home, as a homeowner, it was 95% LTV and the rate is like in the threes, right? Which is absurd, but that's what they're doing these days. Yeah. If you do that, one of the best ways of getting your foot in the door is either the FHA or conventional, like house hacking, you know, living in a house that you're fixing up. But whatever you do, living in a house that's maybe a little bit below what you could buy if you stretch your income. And then once you move out, keep that as a rental. And that way, since it was a little bit below what you could have done if you pushed it, you can still qualify for a new mortgage with that property in your tow. So that's kind of the exceptions. Getting your foot in the door, there's a lot of more conventional routes that you can use, especially kind of using homeowner financing and you know living in a house and then moving on and keeping that as a rental. It's a great way to get started. So I would make that very quick kind of note on the exceptions about getting your foot in the door is really more, it's actually easier in some ways. Financing angle than
it's a really good
than
point
the financing the, investment property.
It's a really good point because initially the first jump is always let's go to hard money, let's go to private money. Mm-hmm. What you're saying is go check out Fannie.
Yeah.
Go check out your community bank. And to a lot of people, they don't really think about that as an option. They think real estate investing, they'll think non-conventional. Hey, cool, I got to go check out my local hard money lender. How would I even go find a community bank to work with? Just cold call, set up a meeting?
I think on that side, a lot of people are just thinking in the same time. They're thinking like they need to scale really quickly and buy a bunch of properties and be like, you know, do the guru stuff. And it's like, no.
Yeah.
real estate is a slow game. You know, it's a long, it's a get rich slow scheme. So you can take the slower route. That's okay. Yeah. But when you get into buying properties, investment properties, and getting loans on them, the best route we found is community banks. Those are your local banks that have one or a couple of branches, mostly in your area.
Yeah.
And there are a few ways to find them. I mean, one, they're advertising, but you know, you can just look, you know, Google banks, but I think the best ways to do it, first of all, is just to go to your local REIA group or go on to a forum of investors or property managers in your area. One, they often bring, you know, sometimes they have people there, you know, advertising, handing out cards. That means they're interested in investment properties if they're going to be showing up at REIA groups, you know, real estate investment associations. But at the same time, investors are often, they're going to be shy about recommending contractors because they're using them all the time. But nobody's shy about recommending banks because if you, the bank has enough money to lend to both of you. And in addition, if you refer a bank and you give them more business, they like you more and they're more likely to do business with you. So just ask, like, find investors that are doing the same thing you are and which banks are they using? Let other people do your legwork for you. And that really gets you a long way. There's one other kind of odd way that we found, and this is sort of going off of how people market for properties, often market for motivated sellers. And that is, we just go to like ListSource and I look up, okay, what are where areas we have properties in? Okay. So we have a lot of properties in the zip code 64030. So I look at that zip code. And then I look at properties that got a loan on them in the last year in the price range that we're looking at, because you can sort by all this data, and that are non-owner occupant, in other words, investment properties. And so then you get a list of all the properties that got loans on them in that time period, and you find which were banks, and you find which ones were like multiple. If they've made like 5, 6, 7 investment loans in that area, they've lent to other people doing the exact same thing you are. Why wouldn't they lend to you?
So let's go to the next question that I have then is, when you find these people, you go to ListSource, first of all, that's a phenomenal idea, right? You go to ListSource, do your filters, non-owner occupied, and just give them a buzz.
Yeah.
How do you initially build that relationship? Question one, part one. Part two is, now you have to put a deck together. You have to put a presentation together. How do you do that? What goes into this presentation?
Yeah, I'd say the first thing is, you just call them up and ask them if this is something they're interested at, you know, kind of tell them a little bit about yourself. And it's like, this is par for the course. Invite them out for lunch and you pay for the lunch. They might try to, but you make sure that you pay for it. And then during this time,
why is that important? Why is it important that you pay for lunch and not?
I think part of it is just a psychological thing of a reciprocation. If somebody does something nice for you, you want to do something nice for them, even if it's not of equal size, you know? So it's like you give them a lunch, they give you a loan, but you come off as if you are professional, you appreciate their time, you appreciate that you can afford it. I mean, it just seems like you're not out there to leech a free lunch off of them and you are, and also acting very appreciative of the time that they're giving you. In terms of, you know, listening out, you know, hearing out your proposal, what you're looking to do.
So building a relationship.
But the big thing is building a relationship, building rapport. Don't spend the whole lunch talking about what you want to do, your loan. I mean, ask them what kind of stuff what are their targets? What are they trying to do as a bank? Ask the person you're meeting with about their own life, you know, chit chat with them. I mean, business is not some, you know, technical problem where you're making an instructions manual to like a nuclear power plant. It's a people business, and
it's so true. You got to shoot the bleep with them. You got to talk. You get to know who they are on a personal level. And when you do that, then it becomes so much easier. It's like having a spotlight right above you. And if you're talking 80% of the time, if you're shining the spotlight on yourself 80% of the time, you're screwing up. You're doing it absolutely wrong, right? It's got to be 20% you talk, 80% they're talking. Like if we were doing this podcast and I'm sitting here talking 100% of the time, you're like, why the heck am I even here, right? Like nobody wants to listen to that.
I'm just here for the looks, right?
You know, right. I mean, we need another pretty face.
Eye candy. Actually, it's not.
Eye candy for sure.
Yeah.
So now you've built a relationship. How do you present? Like, how do you submit that first proposal? What's in it?
I think the big issue here is they want a document submission. And so like they want you to submit all your documents, right? And this is where you should really show how professional you are. Because the big thing to remember is a confused mind says no. This is a really important point. If your document submission is a mess, if it comes in 1,000 different pieces, they're just gonna, you know, a lot of investors have that experience with a bank where it's like you submit, you know, you ask them, they say, oh yeah, we're interested. And then like, not only do you not get a no, but you get a you get a no like four months later or 5 months later. Like it takes them a ton of time. And part of that's their fault, but part of it might be yours and your submission was a mess. You want to make it very obvious what you do. So I want to give it all to them in one time. I don't want to send 5, 6, 7 emails. I don't want to drop a part here and then a next part in a week. So I send them either a Google Drive doc, a Dropbox, or give them a flash drive. I break it down into several parts. And the first part of the folder is just like there's 3 folders and then a couple of documents. I have a business plan. I have basically a loan summary that explains like this is a bit about our business in written form. This is how we're structured. This is the loan that we're presenting. This is why we think it's a good deal. I have the data tape, which lists the properties that are in it. So this is a portfolio. We usually bring like 3 to 10 properties to a bank at once. So it lists each property there. And it could be, if you have 2, that's fine. Even if you have 1, you can have a big thing about your 1 property. That's fine.
Yeah.
I have the company documents. I have our tax returns. I have our operating statements. I have our balance sheets. I have our rent roll, our age receivables. That's how many people are behind on their rent. I have my personal financial statement. I have also my brother's and my father's. And then I have all those company documents.
Yeah.
Then I have like a personal thing where I have our resumes. They often want driver's license. So I have copies of those.
Yeah.
I have, again, our personal financials and then the portfolio. So I have another folder that has the data tape, a pro forma, which is just an estimate of how well the properties will do in the future. And then, and there's many that you can find online that are good templates for that. I have pictures of the properties, and then I have the rent rolls, the operating statements, the age receivables, and the balance sheets for each of the properties. So I provide every document they could possibly want, and I try to walk them through it.
Yeah.
Then I submit that to them all at once. And then I tell them like, hey, it's a lot to go through. And now it might not be with different, depends on who's submitting, but
sure.
I tell them it's a lot to go through. And then I follow up and, you know, I call them like, now you've had a chance to go through it. Let's, you know, let me answer any questions, or I can kind of explain the structure verbally. And that might make it easier to look at. So giving it all to them in one place, that's very intuitive. And you have all those documents right there in front of it. First of all, you've shown that you're professional. You've shown that you have good accounting, which is very important and very underrated. You've shown that you, you know, have your stuff together. You value their time. And I mean, they are going to subconsciously, maybe consciously, but at least subconsciously think, okay, this person has their act together on their document presentation. They must have their act together elsewhere. Because remember, the lender you're talking to is not the person who usually can make the decision. They have to go to committee.
Yeah.
But they are going to be your advocate at committee.
Especially,
and so you need to get them on your side in every way you can. And you're going to do that by building rapport at that lunch and over the phone and a very good document submission.
Especially if you make it easy for them. Dude, that is the truth.
Make it easy for them, as easy as possible.
So we've got to go. We need to have you back. This was great. This is great information, and I just like to make it super quick. But if you want to check out Andrew, do so. Go to andrewsirius.com. You can also check out the YouTube channel, The Sirius Brothers, which I think is the awesomest name ever. And they just released a video talking about the eviction tsunami, right? And how that may or may not implode the market. So I'm not going to go into that right now, but you should absolutely go check it out. It's the first blog post on his website, andrewsirius.com. And it's a really good video. You talk about a lot of technical stuff. You go through everything that you need to know about why this is not going to be the case and how it's not going to upend this economy, which I think is fantastic. So, Andrew, thanks so much, man. I really appreciate it.
Thank you for having me. It was great to be here.
You got it. We'll do it again. The next segment is brought to you by RCN Capital. Now, rcncapital.com, check them out. It's RCN Capital is a national direct private lender that provides commercial loans for the purchase and refinance of non-owner occupied residential and commercial properties. The company specializes in ground-up construction financing, short-term fix and flip, long-term rental financing. Check them out. Go to www.rcncapital.com for more information. What I want to do real quick is talk about tips for buying from wholesalers. All right, tips for buying from wholesalers. And I thought, if we've got two different cameras here, I got to talk to this one. Andrew Sirius, our guest for today's show, wrote this article on thinkrealty.com on the blog, so you absolutely should check it out. And when you're buying from wholesalers, what do you need to know? One of the things that he talks about is, one, where do you find these guys and gals? Right? You can find them at your local meetups. You can find them now that getting together is becoming more prevalent in person. Shake some hands if you're comfortable with that. Maybe do an elbow or two. But go to re-events. Go to re-events. And I like to go through my spam box. It's something that he mentions here, too. He's like, hey, quote, while this would lead to a lot of spam emails if you just, you know, submit your email to everybody's list, check out your, like, your email might go to spam, but then you also, your Google email or Outlook email may automatically filter their emails into your spam box. So it's funny, I'll find a lot of gold in my spam box, surprisingly enough. Number two, he talks about how do you land deals with wholesalers? Quote, wholesalers need end buyers who will close quickly and will quickly stop paying attention to offers from buyers who back out. So essentially, if you are working with a wholesaler, and if you say you're going to do something, show up to the plate and actually do it, make it happen. And that's when your name gets tossed around a real buyer's bucket. Super important that you need to, that you know that. So wholesalers want to work with buyers that are real, and you just start getting more deals that way. So really, really good tips. Check out this blog from Andrew Sirius. Go to thinkrealty.com, the education section. Click down to the blog and you'll see everything there. So that's the show, guys. If you have any questions, absolutely get in touch. Got to give a shout out to today's sponsor, Rentify. But before I do that, want to make sure that we've got Baltimore coming up, right? The Think Realty Hybrid Conference and Expo in Baltimore coming up September 18th and 19th. Go check it out. It's going to be awesome. You can be there in person. You can also be there online, virtually, live as well. You'll be selling those tickets. I think we're doing are we doing a BOGO? Yeah, we're doing a BOGO. So if you go to thinkrealty.com, you click on the Baltimore event, type in the code podcast, and you get a 2-for-1 deal. You got a 2-for. So that's pretty sweet. So thanks so much. Certainly appreciate it. You know how to get to me online. Hit me up anywhere online at Abhi Golhar. And a huge shout out to Rentify, who's the sponsor for today's podcast. Rentify is a verification platform that allows property management companies and real estate investors to instantly verify a prospective renter's financial information. The bank check report provides a summary of payroll, income, rent, bill payment history, etc. Check them out. Go to www.trustrentify.com. Use coupon code ThinkRealty for 20% off of your purchase price. So that's what we got. Until next time, Think Realty Nation, happy investing.